So let my life be the proof of your love. Let my love look like you and what you made.
I'm going to continue in the book of Colossians. And as usual, I'll go through the message, and then I'll open it up for your questions and your comments. And tonight we're going to cover just a few verses, actually. We're not going to cover very much. Colossians chapter 1, verse 21 to 23. And as usual, there's more than we can cover in one night, really. I mean, there's just so much here, and yet at the same time, I want to try and make it as quick as possible because there's a lot of questions that can come up. And so I want to be able to address questions. I do not guarantee any answers, but I want to feel the questions. So just know that. this passage is Colossians chapter 1, verse 21 to 23. Before we get into the passage, I want to start with something that probably we have all experienced and are experiencing. And that is this, that people want to change. They want to change their person. They want to change their appearance, right? They want to stand. They want to change their standing. We don't have much standing in the family. We want to do things that the whole family will say, wow, look at. Or in our work, our places of employment, or our reputation. Some of us want to grow hair, for instance. We want to change something, but, you know, but we all want to change something in our lives. And I find it amazing how much effort and money is put into it. I don't know how many times that I've seen situations and people have come talk to me and they have had Botox of one way or another, either bigger breasts or bigger behinds or, you know, surgery for their bellies because they want to feel more as a woman, more as a man, more as this or that, and they're trying to transform their lives, their appearance. And of course, our social media is a big giant about that, right? People post pictures, their best pictures, right? They do not post the bad ones. They spend hours getting ready for that selfie. Click, now is that good? No, click, no, click, 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 click. Finally, 1 of 100 might be good enough to post. And it's a terrible thing because then other people see it and it's like, oh, look, oh, I'll never look like that. Well, yeah, it took hours and hours and maybe lots of money to get there. And then it was one moment. And then it's all gone again. But why? Why? Because, listen to this, because people do not like themselves. At bottom, there's something wrong. And we can deny it. We can try to rationalize it away, but the reality is, at some level, we do not like ourselves. Where do I get that from? From our parents. Well, I don't mean our immediate parents, though they're part of it. I mean our great, 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 great parents, right? Adam and Eve. What happened when they sinned? The text tells us they were both naked and were not ashamed. This was before the fall. After the fall, they hid themselves from God and they covered themselves. They were alienated from God and they were alienated from one another. Somehow they knew deep in their profound being that they were guilty. Something was wrong with them. And that has been passed on all the way to us. All the way to us. And then, if in life we experience a home where love was in short supply, if any at all, guess what? we begin to develop a starvation for holy, loving connections that are simply not there. And again, just automatically, because our hearts are deceitful, somehow we come up with ideas that, okay, now I know the problem is something to do with me and I can fix it. I can fix it. And here we go. We're going to transform ourselves. We're going to change ourselves. I'm going to become more educated. I'm going to become smarter. I'm going to become stronger. I'm going to become the best of this or whatever because I'm going to change myself. And God knows where we are. And God knows that we simply cannot do it. Simply cannot do it. Throughout the biblical history, people try to change their status. Right? Why did Cain kill Abel? Why did Lamech kill other men? You can just go on down the line. Person after person as the person in the Bible. They were going to change themselves. They were going to transform themselves. And create situations where they would be acceptable, respected, loved, whatever it is. But they were going to do it themselves. And it's an ongoing problem. Even today, as I have discussed. And if we begin to be honest with ourselves, we begin to see very clearly that in ourselves too. Now, to proceed with solidity, let's turn to Ephesians chapter 2, just by way of introduction. Ephesians chapter 2, this is the Apostle Paul giving a diagnosis of humanity. This is one of those passages like when you go to the doctor and you have something's wrong with your throat, what does he do? He gets this little stick. And he says, say ah, and he sticks his ah. Oh, I know what's wrong with you. Right? This is a divine spiritual examination. And he says, say ah, and this is what he finds. Right? Ephesians chapter 2, starting in verse 1. And you were dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you formerly walked according to the course of this world, according to the prince of power of the air, and the spirit that is now working in the sons of disobedience. Among them, we too all. This includes this preacher, everyone that's sitting right there. It's all of us. Formerly lived in the lust of our flesh and in the mind, and were by nature. See, this is what I say. I know. Not because I'm a genius, but because the Word of God reveals it, right? From Adam and Eve, by nature, children of wrath, even as the rest, right? But God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love, which he loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace, you have been saved. So this was our condition, all humanity. And God had to come along and make changes, make transformations. Again, by way of introduction, just another passage, 1 Corinthians chapter 5. 1 Corinthians chapter 5. Here the Apostle Paul is encouraging the Corinthians, but he has to confront some things, but now he's going to encourage them and say, 1 Corinthians 5 chapter verse 17, I'm sorry, I think it's 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Sorry, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. Verse 17 and 18. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creature. The old things have passed away. Behold, new things have come. Now, all these things are from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. The ministry of reconciliation. And that's what God had to do. God had to do the work to make things right between us, between humanity and God and us, right? He had to do the work, and he did it. So we need to be about the same ministry. That's what it says there, verse 18, right? He gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Are we involved in that? Are we involved in mending relationships? Especially the relationship with God? And again, people come to me all the time, broken marriages or, you know, struggling with relationships. And, you know, we have to, it's hard. And it's very painful. But the main first thing is what? To help them with their relationship with God. That's first and foremost. Because then all other relationships can get better, possibly, if both want the truth. But the first thing is relationship with God. And once we have that, then we can help others, right? We can help others. And why do we want to do that? Because many reasons, but two of the main reasons is because of this. When we have loving, holy relationships, this is what fuels our soul. And it's very easy to see. I know as a married man, when my wife and I are not good, it's just miserable. But when we're good, buddy. Man, Satan can just about throw anything in. We're fine. Because she and I are okay. We're doing good. Right? And the same way with God. When we have a good, honest, holy relationship with God, man, powerful. Right? Because we had everything we need spiritually. But when we're not, any little thing and Satan can get in there and do a mess. By the time I know it, we're screaming at each other and we're mad and angry and away we go. Right? So that's why we want to help people. We want to help them have reconciled relationships. Right? But there's a bigger reason than that. A much, much, much bigger reason why we want to help people in reconciliation with God and with one another. You know why? Because this is what glorifies God. This is what glorifies God. How is that? Well, what do we know from the scriptures? That God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit are three distinct individuals, but they're so united that they are but one God. And it is profound. It's going to take eternity to understand that. But nonetheless, we're told that truth, biblical truth, right? Three distinct persons, but one God. And that unity is based on truth, is based on love, right? Is based on holiness. And so when we are acting in holy, loving relationships based on truth, we are reflecting God. And when we reflect God, we are glorifying God. And that's why we want to move and help people, right? In reconciliation with God and with one another. But what did I say? That reconciliation is based on truth, not just playing games, right? We can pretend to have a unity. We can posture in such a way that, oh, everything's happy, and we want to kill you, but I mean, that's the truth. And I don't know about you, but I want to honor my Lord Jesus Christ. I want to glorify God. So, what about you? Are you looking to change the superficial? Are you working really hard to look good in the lives of other people? Do you know friends that are spending so much time and effort in just the superficial? Are you working really hard to change your life? What part of your life? Maybe you're not working at all. You just want to get by life, man. How am I going to pay the bills tomorrow? That's all I'm worried about. As long as, you know, me and my children don't argue. And if we start arguing, call McDonald's, man. Go get some more hamburgers or something. Make peace in that way. I don't know how. But how are we? Is there some growth, real, substantial, deep changes happening? And then, of course, we raise the question, what is really worth changing? If we decide to change something in our lives, what is really worth it? Because if it's not worth it, I can spend 5, 10, 20 years changing something. There's going to be nothing. It's going to be a royal waste of time. Well, I'll tell you what the scriptures have to say. The Apostle Paul says in Galatians 4, 17 or 19 that Christ be formed in you. Christ-likeness. That's what's really worth it. And the Apostle Paul says, man, I'm in labor. Galatians 4, 19. Until Christ be formed in you. That's what's really worth it. And to ask the question of ourselves, what needs to change? Because when I look in the mirror, I don't exactly look like Jesus Christ in character. I need to change. Now, these three verses in Colossians chapter 1, Colossians chapter 1 and verse 21, 22, and 23, let me read them. And the Apostle Paul is talking to the Colossians. And when you read the first few verses of Colossians chapter 1, man, they were doing great. They were doing really good. And the Apostle then says, I know you're doing really good, but you know what? I want you to increase in your understanding, in your knowledge of Jesus Christ. Because the battles sometimes are complex, and they're very intense conflicts, and there are philosophical argumentations that Satan can send that sound really good, and they sound very convincing. They have very cogent arguments to make it sound good and reasonable, but they're not biblical, and so many people are being misled. Higher education, quote unquote, but they're not biblical. And so the Apostle Paul is telling the Colossians, man, I really want you to understand and increase your knowledge of Christ. And so we begin verse 21. And although, and here's something that we read out of Ephesians, right? And although you were formerly alienated and hostile in mind, engaged in evil deeds, yet he has now reconciled you in his fleshly body through death in order to present you before him holy and blameless and beyond reproach. If indeed you continue in the faith firmly established and steadfast and not moving away from the hope of the gospel that you have heard, which was proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and of which I, Paul, was made a minister. God has done the greatest work, the impossible work, that was needed to transform us into a Jesus-honoring life person. God has done the impossible work to transform us, to change us into a Jesus-honoring person. That is worth it. To become more Jesus-honoring in our lives. There's nothing greater. In fact, that's what we're here on earth for. You know, I've told you before from this pulpit, and I literally told God this. God, what's up? Let's put it in terms of money. You've paid a few trillion dollars to get me to heaven, meaning your only begotten son, the eternal son of God, died for me? I mean, trillions and trillions and trillions of dollars so I could go to heaven? And God, I want to go to heaven now. I mean, I do. What's up? You paid all this for me, God, and I want to go. I want you to talk about Jesus Christ to other people. Oh. I suspect that none of us really, okay, I'm going to talk about Jesus, but I'd rather be in heaven. No, I want you to speak about the mercy of God. I want you to speak about the beauty of my son. I want you to speak about the royal love that I have for people. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, his eternal, holy son. Well, that's a lot of love. And I want you to talk about it. And I want every single one of you, those that are watching on TV or on the internet. That's the purpose God has us here for. You see? And this passage shows us that, you know, God did everything necessary, the impossible work to transform us, into Jesus honoring persons. So here we go. Verse 21. Although you were formerly alienated and hostile in mind, and literally by doing evil. Literally, that's what it's saying. So, this was the way of life. You had been made strangers by the fall, right? Sin, without connection, hostile in mind. In other words, what he's saying is this, and I'm going to put it in words that some of us may understand. You were all a bunch of junkyard dogs. You know what a junkyard dog looks like and what he does? A junkyard dog will hear a noise, you know, a mile away, and he starts growling and barking, and he's just mean. Somebody tries to jump the fence on the junkyard, that dog is all over him. They're just mean cusses. And basically, that's what Paul is saying. Formerly, you were just mean cusses, junkyard dogs. That's what you were. And what he says there, by evil deeds, by immoral, ungodly, wicked deeds. And the sense is this. In your anger towards God, you were misbehaving. You were doing wicked things to get at God. Now, most of us are not aware of that. But if we look at life experiences, we can readily identify them, right? For those of us that are married, sometimes we just do things because we're angry at our spouse. And we could get a jab in there. I want to get that other jab. I want to say a joke. But deep down, there's a hostility. And sometimes it's not subtle, right? It's a direct jab. And then, okay, it's too uncomfortable to talk about that in the spouse. Okay, let's talk about children. A little bit more comfortable, right? A little bit less threatening. What? You know, we had five. And there were some times that our children just rebelled out of anger. And I knew it was against me. I knew it was against, you know, my wife. Because they weren't liking what we were telling them. And they would do stuff. I mean, we've had a number of handymen come over and patch up works on the walls. Because our children are, boom, a big old hole right there. What happened? I don't know, it must have been. And they named one of the siblings. And we knew, come on. If you have had children, sometimes they do. I mean, even when little toddlers, man. You know, they could kick a bucket or something. And they get older and they got worse things. And then if they don't do it outwardly, they do it inwardly. You see? And we can see it all over the place. In the workplace. In school, right? You hate a teacher, and guess what? Well, here the Apostle Paul is saying, we do those things against God. Before Jesus Christ, we were all given to wrath. And especially because we were alienated and hostile in mind towards God. You know, sometimes that's why we don't pray. That's why we don't go to the scriptures. You know what, God? You're not behaving. I don't think I'm going to talk to you. Hi, you're not answering my prayer. You want me to read your word? Yeah, right. And if we're honest, but it's hard to be honest at times. It's very hard to be honest, right? Who wants to tell their parents off? Unless nowadays, in our times, they do it all the time. There's massive disrespect, you know? But if we're honest, there's something deep within us that's just, and so I'm not going to submit to you, God. You know, I'm not going to submit to you. Your children messed me over, so I want to obey you, yeah. The Apostle Paul is saying, and although you were formerly alienated and hostile in mind, meaning the very intentions, the very thinking, behaving in ways to get back at God without even knowing it, without even being conscious of it. Praise be to God for verse 22. Look at verse 22. Yet he has now, the relationship has been changed. It's been transformed. Instead of having this anger towards God, but now, he has reconciled you in his fleshly body. Reconciled. A transforming of a state of being. Right? We get into fights. We had one of the testimonies this evening. We were in a fight. Our marriage was going really, really bad, but we reconciled. Right? There was a transformation. God has so worked it to where our state of being, this state of being wrathful and angry towards God, has been changed. You see, it's not that God has changed. He worked it to where we changed, and there's a different relationship now with him. You see? And it is very, very important to recognize when we don't have that relationship with God. Maybe it's just words, pretty words that we use, that we're Christians, but deep inside, there is an anger towards God. God has done everything. Yet he has now reconciled you in his flesh, his fleshly body. His fleshly, why would he say that? His fleshly body. I thought, the flesh. Right? The flesh, sinful, broken, weak, fallen flesh. Well, the Apostle Paul is saying the flesh is not automatically, because it's a flesh, ipso facto evil. Automatically evil. No. You know why he would say that? Because there was already a dualism and a legalism that was being taught. A dualism simply says there's the spiritual and there's the physical. The spiritual is what's good. The physical is evil. Dualism. And so, let's just be spiritual, spiritual, spiritual. The physical, evil, bad. And Paul is saying, wait. Let's talk about this. No, his fleshly body, the flesh is not automatically bad, especially when it's not fallen, right? God made the flesh and it's beautiful. And by the way, that's why pornography is the biggest money maker ever. What are people looking at? The highest, most beautiful of creation. But it is perverted, it's used pervertedly. You see? But it is the highest of creation. But when it is fallen, now you've got a problem. But Paul is addressing this thing of dualism. Wait a minute. Because then, as I said, oh, the spiritual, the physical, bad, bad. Oh, the sexual things, oh, bad, bad. Oh, anything that's just, you're enjoying food, oh, you're carnal. What in the world is that? You see? And then legalism, it's part of that. You know, if you do that, man, you're spiritually, you're down there in the dump, man. But if you stay away from that, ooh, you're spiritual. You're spiritual. And in the church or anywhere, it's like, man, if you dress a certain way, you're spiritual. You don't dress a certain way, boo, I don't know about you. You know, if you talk a certain way, you're really spiritual. You don't talk that way, you're just carnal down there. Legalism. And then you better behave that way I want you to behave. You better talk the way I want you to talk. Never mind the heart. Never mind what the heart is going through. Just behave the way you're supposed to behave. Legalism. And the Apostle Paul is saying, through his fleshly body. John 1:14 says what? The Gospel of John, chapter 1 and verse 14. And he became flesh. He became flesh. One of the greatest miracles that has ever happened. That God, who is bigger than the whole universe, omnipresent, meaning he's present in and out of universe, he's bigger than anything. And he took on flesh? How does that work? All of a sudden, our mind blow a few fuses, right? We can't figure it out. But he took on flesh, the Bible says. You see? And the Apostle Paul is making a point through his fleshly body. And then here's another thing. It wasn't that he just appeared as a man. Right? Seemed like he was a man walking around. No, 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 no. He was a historical human being that walked around here on earth. There was historical reality. Because we can get off into fantasy all the time. Right? The Christian message, well, it's just fairy tales. It's just for people to feel good. No, 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 no. This can be historically verified. You see? And that's what he's getting at as well. The Colossians were wrestling with all these animations and demigods and spiritual knowledge and all this. And Paul's grounding them in historical reality. In his fleshly body. Through death. Meaning the cross. Right? Meaning the cross. Here's another thing that he's addressing. There had to be a price paid. Can God die? If he's God, no. How can God die? Well, God says, I'll take on flesh. I'll become a human being so I can die. Wow. Wow. And again, I can't explain it all. So, whoever paid for all of our sins had to be two things simultaneously. He had to be eternal. He had to be divine. He had to be all-powerful to be able to pay for all of our sins of all people, of all time. Who can do that but God? Right? So, this person who would die for all of our sins had to be God himself. At the same time, he had to be able to die. He had to become a man to be able to die. Right? Through his death. There it is. You see? In order that, here's the purpose, right? Here's the purpose. And brothers and sisters, you and I need to be involved in this. Because this is God's purpose. Look at what he says. Look at what he says. In order that, to present you before him. The word there, to present, may be an indication that this is a legal presentation. This is a presentation. Okay, judge, here's so-and-so being presented before the judge. What's the evidence? What's the argumentation? Guilty or not guilty? Jesus died to present us legally before the ultimate judge of judges. And how is he going to present us? How? What does the text say? Right? Holy and blameless and beyond reproach. Anybody want to claim that on their own? Without Jesus Christ, we cannot claim that. Right? God had to do the impossible, the absolutely impossible. He had to do it for us. And that's what he did. Holy and blameless, beyond reproach. Wow. Wow. How in the world can he present us before the ultimate judge like that? How can he do that? You know how? 1 John chapter 2, verse 1 and 2 tell us. He is the propitiation. 1 John chapter 2. 1 John chapter 2. My little children, I am writing to you these things so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate, we have a lawyer, we have an attorney on retainer for eternity. We have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And what does it say? He himself is the propitiation for our sins. And not only for ours only, but for those for the whole world. What is propitiation? Propitiation. If you do something wrong, you stole $10. What do you deserve? You need to pay $10, but maybe don't do that again. Okay, too much. How about if you steal $1 million? What do you deserve? What if you go and in your anger and your rage, you kill somebody? What do you deserve? You see, what we deserve, the judgment that we deserve, is eternal condemnation in hell. That's what we deserve. In other words, a forever, boom, 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 forever. And when there's enough booms, satisfaction. Okay, justice has been done. Jesus took all the fist from God the Father and satisfied the righteous wrath of God. That's propitiation. Jesus took all the punishment for us and he satisfied the Father. So when we're presented before the judge and Jesus comes up and says, yeah, Dad, he's guilty. But do you remember, Dad? Do you remember, Dad? I took it. That's right. Usher him in. Beyond reproach.
holy.
Oh my goodness. Wow. Wow. And that's what the Apostle Paul is getting at.
He took on flesh so that he would die and take upon all our sins through death, so that he would present us holy and blameless beyond reproach.
My goodness. If we were to understand that Jesus did that. Not anyone else in the whole world. Not our spouse, not our children, not our parents, not our uncles, aunts, not the Pope, not Billy Graham, nobody. Jesus did that. And I repeat that, Jesus did that. You know why? Because we began to look at other people that messed us over. Well, look at how they messed me over. You want me to go to church? Yeah, right. And Jesus says, are they the ones that took it for you? Or did I? If I'm the one, then who do you need to be focusing on? You see? Who do you need to be focusing on? Focus on the Lord Jesus Christ, who is the satisfaction of all our punishment before God. He is worthy to live for now and for eternity. You see? That's what Paul is getting at. And so now he says in verse 23, he puts it as a conditional verse. If indeed you continue in the faith, meaning let's assume that you do, let's assume that you're going to continue. And wouldn't you like to continue? In a sense, this conditional class is saying, come on, respond. Don't you think it would be a good idea that you continue firm in the faith? Established and steadfast. The wording there, somebody pointed out, is like a military that is very, very disciplined and orderly. And they had dug trenches against the enemy, and they are established. You see, when we know the Lord Jesus Christ and what God has done, man, we can continue in the faith no matter how hard it gets. I can continue loving no matter how hard life gets. That's why when we read, for instance, fellow believers who were in the gulags of Russia, underground churches in China, who are being killed for their faith, and they still praise God, oh my goodness, it puts us to shame, right? For heaven's sakes, our air conditioner goes out in our car and we're going to have a heart attack. We're so spoiled rotten, right? No, the Apostle Paul says, man, when you're established and steadfast and not moved away from the hope of the gospel that you have heard, which was proclaimed in all creation under heaven, and of which I, Paul, have become a minister. Do not be moved by the faith in the gospel. The faith in the fact that Jesus Christ died for our sins and rose again from the dead. Don't be moved by that. But we have to say it over and over. Why? Because so many things move us, right? Any little thing and we're thrown off track. And we stop loving people. We become defensive. And we put walls around our hearts. And we're not going to give anything because I've been taken advantage of. And Jesus comes back and says, how many punches did I have to take for you? How many punches did I have to take for you? And nobody has given you anything? Really? Really? You see, brothers and sisters, when we begin to understand what God has done to transform us from a place of hostility towards Him and a hostility towards one another. This state of being, to have peace between us, peace between God and us. Oh my goodness. You see? So, you know, how are we to live then? How are we to live? You know, most of us would say, you know, probably I'm not living like that. Probably I'm not living the way Paul is suggesting here that I ought to live. What do we need? What do we need? You know what we don't need? What we do not need is more pressure. Pressure. Oh man, I better talk to at least 5 person a month about the Jesus. Man, pressure. I better pressure. No. We don't need more pressure. Turn to Isaiah 30. Isaiah 30. Because this is applicable throughout the whole Bible when it comes to how then do we then live. Isaiah 30 and verse 15. Isaiah 30 and verse 15. For thus says the Lord God, the Holy One of Israel, has said, in repentance and rest you shall be saved. In quietness and trust is your strength. How odd, no? How odd. The world says, man, get up and do it. Pressure. You gotta do more. You gotta do more. You gotta be pressure. No. The problem is not that we haven't tried anything. Oh, we have tried. Man, we try. We work so hard for money and education and proving ourselves. We work hard, but we're working hard at the wrong thing with the wrong motivation. You see, the problem is sin. That's the problem. It's not that we don't have enough brains, enough money, enough education. No, the problem is sin. We're trying to do it on our own, apart from Jesus Christ. And so the first thing is, repent. In repentance and rest, you shall be saved. In quietness and trust is your strength. It's no wonder that Jesus says, come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give rest for your souls. You see? But how does the verse end? How does the verse end? But you were not willing. It comes to a choice, no? It comes to a choice. So will you? As you wrestle with temptations, because we all wrestle with temptations in life. We all wrestle with weaknesses and failures. We all do. You know? And what's the solution? To try harder? No. It's to repent and trust in the Lord, because He's the one that took the punishment for me, for you and me. He's the one that's transforming us. You see? You see that? Because so much of Christianity is pressure. No. That's the first application. Repent, rest in the Lord, trust in the Lord, instead of trying harder. Verse 22 of Colossians, chapter 1. Verse 22. Yet He has now reconciled you in His fleshly body through death. Here's one of the greatest miracles, right? As I mentioned before already. that God would take on flesh? Can you imagine that? Being in absolute perfection in heaven, perfect everything, and letting that aside to come to this earth and take on flesh? Wow. And then going on ahead and dying for us? My goodness. What's the proper response? Isn't the response like falling down and worshiping Him? Worshiping the Lord Jesus Christ? You see, I'm afraid, brothers and sisters, and many times that's why our worship is so superficial. Our worship is so weak. Because we do not understand the awesome work of Christ for us. That He would take on flesh? Oh my goodness. I mean, being God? I mean, what would you and I think? Well, I'm going to look like a fool. People are going to take advantage of me. I'm going to look stupid. He didn't care because of love. And He took on flesh. We need to worship the Lord Jesus Christ. And I'm not saying just Sunday morning, brothers and sisters. It's throughout life. Throughout every moment of the day. Everywhere that I am. Right? Worship the Lord Jesus Christ. So that's my second application. For my last application, verse 23, of course, is, you know, living in a way that honors Jesus, right? A Jesus-honoring life. For that, turn to 1 Peter chapter 4. 1 Peter chapter 4. And I'm just going to read and make a few comments about the first three verses of 1 Peter chapter 4. Therefore, since Christ has suffered in the flesh, arm yourselves also with the same purpose. Because he who has suffered in the flesh has ceased from sin, so as to live the rest of the time in the flesh, no longer for the lust of men, but for the will of God. For the time already past is sufficient for you to have crucified out of the desire of the Gentile, or carried out the desires of the Gentile, having pursued a course of sensuality, lust, drunkenness, carousing, drinking parties, and abominable idolatry. You see, anything that fits in my life, I need to get rid of it. Now, does that mean that all pleasure is gone? Of course not. We would go back to dualism. We would go back to legalism. That's not the point. But if in my life that's what I'm going for all the time, that's what drives me, something is up. Something is up. You see? We're to live for Him. A Jesus-honoring life. A Jesus-honoring life. Listen to this. Does not depend on my spouse. Does not depend on my children. Does not depend on the other church members to behave. It depends on my relationship to the Lord. Because He's the one that took all the punches for eternity for me. You see? And so no matter what comes, to say, I want to live a Jesus-honoring life. Will you? I can yell and scream and do all kinds of stuff up here, but I'm powerless against your will, right? I am absolutely powerless. And God is a gentleman too. God is a gentleman. Here's the offer. Will you?